My thanks, first of all, thanks to Michael. Thanks to Kenesha Williams for the arrangements, to JoJo and Daniel. It takes a village to do this kind of thing, as you can tell from all the people who are lined up in the back. And I'm delighted to see all of your faces here, and actually see at least most of your faces, I guess, because I've been doing, in promoting my book, I've been doing a certain amount of Zoom conversation, and that's a funny experience because it's kind of like talking to yourself. I mean, we've all done a little bit of Zoom, I imagine, and it's strange. It's much nicer to be able to see that I've just put the guy in the second row to sleep, or that somebody in the third row is laughing at my joke. So I'm glad you're all here. This book has an origin story that I'm going to tell you, and that is that I've been writing about architecture, as Michael said, for a number of years. I've done a number of books. In fact, I've done two about your own Frank Lloyd Wright, you Chicagoans, you, and a couple books about Thomas Jefferson. And there were really three principal American architects, if you look at American architecture from the perspective of the world, the third being Henry Hobson Richardson. And I made a case to my editor after doing my last book, which concerned Frank Lloyd Wright, in fact, that I should write a book about Richardson because he's relatively unknown in our time, although in his time, he was a very big deal. In fact, the year before he died, which he did in 1886, a publication called the American Architect and Building News conducted a survey, and they asked 100 architects, there we go, 100 architects and builders who they thought had designed, or that what the finest building in America was. And this was the choice of 85% of the people polled. They did a further set of questions, and they said, you know, what are your top 10 buildings? 7 of the top 10 buildings, this being one, were works by Henry Hobson Richardson. So in the middle 1880s, he was the man. He was this very big figure. Anyway, I said as much to my editor, and George, who's a very thoughtful man, George Gibson is his name, nodded and listened and said, okay, that's all well and good, but Hugh, if nobody knows who this guy is, who's going to buy your book? It seemed like a fair question. So a discussion ensued, along with many months of further research. And I learned that Richardson's most essential friend was Frederick Law Olmsted. So in turn, I discovered that Olmsted had underwritten a biography of Richardson, that they had worked together on quite a number of projects, and that Olmsted actually referred to Richardson as the greatest comfort and the most potent stimulus that had ever come into my artistic life. So all of a sudden, I had a book. I had two people to talk about. I had two wonderful sets of projects, buildings, and landscapes. And the book that has recently been published is the result. Now, early on, I came across some reinforcement, namely this. How can a person not want to write a book about an architect with a sense of humor? A guy who wants to dress up as a medieval monk. Of course, lots of his buildings did have a medieval aspect, so I guess that explains it. But as a student of architecture, I knew his work in a general way, but his life story had lots of good elements, you know, victories, enthusiasms, a tragic and premature end. And then there was that friendship, too, of course, that I could explore in the book. Now, I'm going to move on to Olmsted. I want to give you, some of you probably know some of his life story, but I'm going to give you my version of it, if you will. Frederick Law Olmsted was born in 1822, which fortuitously makes this the bicentenary year of his birth. He was born actually just 10 days ago, April 26th, 200 years ago. He's a Connecticut Yankee, born in Hartford. His family had been in Hartford for generations. They were some of the original settlers of Hartford in 1637. His father ran a dry goods store, and Olmsted, Frederick Law Olmsted, traveled with his father and his stepmother extensively as a child. They had a taste for unspoiled countryside, which he later, Olmsted, would call the scenic. But it would be many years before he would make that his life's work. He was doing his college preparation as a teenager when, and he really should have known better, he somehow managed to do a header into a stand of poison sumac. And he got an absolutely awful case of blisters around his eyes. So serious, in fact, that there was some concern that he might lose his vision. And he and his father went to New York. They consulted an ophthalmologist, if that's what you call them in those days, although I'm sure it was a much less sophisticated discipline than we know it today. And the doctor said, this is really not a time for you to be doing a whole lot of reading of books, which is what one had to do to get into Yale, as any good Connecticut Yankee would want to do in the early 19th century. So his college prospects literally went out the window. That was the end of his college time. So instead, he found a mix of other things to do. His father found him a job working as a surveyor. That lasted about 18 months, and he learned, you know, the routine of meets and bounds, but didn't find it much to his liking. He worked as a clerk in a New York dry goods store, commuting back and forth from Brooklyn. I think he learned some mechanistic things, some accounting things, but obviously that wasn't going to satisfy him. He went to sea. He spent a year aboard a clipper going back and forth to China. That agreed with him perhaps even less than any of the previous things had, because when he stepped off the ship back in New York after 12 months aboard, he was so jaundiced and so skinny his father didn't recognize him on the wharf. So he did some other things. Next, he worked as a farmer, which he did kind of like. The first farm that his father bought for him in the Connecticut coast, however, wasn't really large enough that it could make a living. So his father bought him a second farm, this one on Staten Island. He farmed that with some success, but then he decided, well, maybe I like trees better than anything else, so he turned it into a nursery. And that was clicking along well enough, but I think he discovered that, well, as Joni Mitchell put it, he had an urge for going. So he actually became a travel writer. While he was running the farm with one hand, he was traveling through the American South. He was reporting back on what life was like in the slavery South. This was in the 1850s. And in fact, some of his writings, initially for a new newspaper called the New York Daily Times, helped galvanize the abolitionist movement in the North. But he also took a trip to England. Wrote a book about that, too, called Walks and Talks of an American Farmer. It was published in 1852. And it was while traveling and researching that book that he visited a place called Birkenhead. It's immediately across the Mersey from Liverpool. And in Birkenhead, there was a new park, something unlike anything he had ever seen before. Think of it as Central Park writ small, just 125 acres, waters, meadows, forests, rolling countryside, bridle paths, and the rest. He described it as a people's garden. And he was really impressed. Now, I am by inclination a narrative historian. Let me give you a picture of Olmsted here. And this is one a little bit later. I like to tell stories. And so the one that follows concerns the moment when Olmsted discovered his vocation after a good many years of something of a vagabond. He was 35, and he became a park maker almost overnight. And it came together kind of by accident. Until August 8th, 1857, Olmsted had been little more than a witness to feats of park making. A writer who liked the parks he had seen in his European travels, but who had played no role in shaping landscapes beyond his own farm on Staten Island. Quite by accident, on a Sunday afternoon in 1857, that all changed. Growing tired of the editing task before him, he was reading proof sheets for a series of articles then running in the New York Daily Tribune beneath the rubric "The Southerners at Home." He rose from his desk to head downstairs in the inn where he was staying near New Haven. He expected to find refreshments in the dining room, but to his delight, he saw a familiar face at one of the tables. The man was Charles Eliot, Eliot made his living as an iron merchant, but his passions lay elsewhere. The author of several books, including one called Cottages and Cottage Life, he had been a protege of Andrew Jackson Downing. Olmsted took a seat, and soon enough the two diners zeroed in on a matter in which they both had an interest. A major park was about to be created on Manhattan Island. Poet and newspaper man William Cullen Bryant and Downing, the era's leading authority on both horticulture and domestic architecture, had begun promoting a park for New York more than a decade earlier. But a key inflection point had been the passage by the New York State Legislature of the Central Park Act in 1853. Since then, the city had acquired the necessary land, and just 4 months earlier, an 11-man commission had been formed to administer construction of the park. One of its charter members was this very same man, Charles Eliot. Sitting next to me at the tea table, Olmsted later remembered, Eliot told me of the history of the commission. The two men's conversation in the course of Olmsted's life began to shift when Eliot explained that the commissioners planned to elect a superintendent at their next meeting. He would be the man charged with managing construction of the park. "Must he be a politician?" Olmsted inquired. Eliot shook his head. No, the park is to be managed independently of politics. Olmsted agreed that a well and equitably run Pequot's Park could do inestimable good, and Eliot, pleased at his friend's enthusiasm, mused aloud that he wished Olmsted were a fellow commissioner. Then, in his next breath, Eliot gave voice to a fresh idea. "Why not take the superintendency yourself?" he asked Olmsted. The possibility of such a job had never crossed Olmsted's mind, but he did not demur. Unexpected as it was, and yet so logical, even inevitable, the idea appealed to him. "I'm not sure I wouldn't if it were offered me," he allowed. No, Eliot explained. "If Olmsted wanted the job, he would have to go to New York. He would have to file an application, and," Eliot warned him, "he would have to fight through the hurly-burly of city politics and bureaucracy." As Olmsted told the story two decades later, he decided in that instant to take the evening boat back to New York. He would think hard on this matter, he told himself, and confided as much in Eliot. "I'll do it if no serious objection occurs to me before morning." None did. And I think we all know what ensued. He pursued the job, was appointed superintendent a month later. With no final plan agreed to, a competition was held for a park design, and Olmsted, together with a man named Calvert Vaux, an English-trained architect who had come to the U.S. to work with Andrew Jackson Downing, who had died in the interim, put together what they called the Greensward Plan. It was one of 33 entries, but theirs would be the winner, and their template became the basis for the park that some of us know today, one that remains remarkably true to its makers' vision. For Olmsted, it was a whirlwind. "I was unexpectedly invited to take a modest public duty," he recalled, "which led him to make landscape architecture my calling in life." He was, in short, handed his dream job, one that he hadn't even known he wanted. It was a public duty that would prove to be anything but modest. He would make America's first major city park, its first park, the essential prototype of all others. Many of those built in the next four decades were of his imagining. Many more would be a part of his legacy when his stepson John and his son Rick took over the practice in the mid-1890s. Now let's meet Henry Hobson Richardson. He was born in New Orleans, came from a well-to-do family. His father was a merchant who bought and sold hardware. On his mother's side, there were substantial plantation holdings on the River Road. They owned slaves. He was handsome, as you can see. He was musical, played the flute, loved to sing. He had a mathematical mind. The headmaster at his school he went to said he was the best mathematical arithmetical student that they'd ever had. He also had a three-dimensional imagination because he could play chess four or five games at a time without a chessboard in front of him. He could keep them all separate in his head. He wanted to be an engineer, and in that era, if you wanted to be an engineer, you had to go to West Point. So he got recommendations from, among other people, Jefferson Davis, to go to West Point. However, he had an interview, and he had a halt in his speech. And the word came back that he really wasn't officer material if he couldn't speak more clearly than that. So he was rejected. He spent a year at the University of Louisiana, which subsequently became Tulane, before matriculating at Harvard. He was stylish. He was a clothes horse all his life. He had an account at Poole's in London, in Savile Row, where he had bespoke clothes made for him. He was a hail fellow, well met, good company, liked to drink, liked to have fun, liked to tell stories. He was very social, and that society, those social connections that he established at Harvard proved to be very valuable to him subsequently, because many of them became his clients. He decided as a senior at Harvard that he wanted to be an architect. Now, in order to be an architect, or to get formal training as an architect, you had to go abroad. There were no architecture schools in the United States at that point. MIT's only came along some years later. So we went to Paris. He went to the École des Beaux-Arts. And that fit him perfectly, except along came the Civil War, and he found himself very much betwixt and between. He felt like he should come back. He felt like he should be a part of this, you know, this terrible war. But he didn't actually know which side he should be on. He didn't really want to fight for the North because he would be shooting it literally at one of his brothers who was an officer in the Confederacy. He didn't really want to fight for the Confederacy because, of course, many of his Harvard classmates had become officers in the Union. So he chose another path altogether, went back to Paris and finished his studies and didn't return until after the Civil War was over. He, while there, had a certain amount of money until the fall of New Orleans when he had no money. And so he found himself working during the day as a draftsman for several French architects, including Theodore Labruste. And at night, he would do his schoolwork. He would work in the atelier of a man named Louis-Jules André, who was teaching him the art of architectural draftsmanship. He had a good friend named Henry Adams, who was at that point in London with his father, who was minister to the court of St. James. They traveled a bit around the UK, around France. He came to know Paris extremely well. And when the war was over, he came back to the United States. Now, he had a fiance in Boston from his Harvard days. And of course, he could have gone to New Orleans because he had family there, because New Orleans was about to become once again, the very prosperous port city that it had been before the war. But he chose not to go to either place, but instead went to New York. His Harvard connections got him some work, some miscellaneous jobs, houses, a renovation at the Century Club. And as soon as he could afford to, he married his Boston sweetheart. There we have her, Julie Hayden. He built him a house on Staten Island. His first child arrived. He was very much a young architect of promise in the late 1860s, when at roughly the same time, Olmsted returned to New York. He'd spent the war, half of it in Washington, D.C., running the Sanitary Commission, which was effectively the medical corps for the U.S. Army. The other 2 years he'd spent in California running mine operations in Mariposa. By happenstance, Olmsted settled in the same Staten Island neighborhood that Richardson did. It's called Clifton. And they both took the ferry daily from Vanderbilt's Landing to their respective offices in Lower Manhattan. Now, precisely when they met is lost to history. But I like to think of them glimpsing one another now and then on that ferry. And one day, by chance, they fall into conversation. Perhaps Olmsted was drawn to Richardson, who had a genuine magnetism about him. Everybody said so. Maybe he made Olmsted smile, or he said something Olmsted hadn't thought of, which probably didn't happen very often, in my opinion. Did Olmsted's intensity and intelligence appeal to Richardson, who was a man of boundless curiosity and enthusiasm? whatever, whenever, they gradually fell into a rare marriage of minds, and by the late 1860s, they were working together. They co-designed a tomb for a cemetery in Washington, D.C. They served on a commission on Staten Island to create a plan for the city's development. Together, they created an extraordinary hospital for the insane in Buffalo. It's a half-mile-long building that looks like it belongs there because Olmsted helped plant it in its park-like setting. Now, I can't very well talk about Richardson and not talk a little bit more about Trinity Church, which was one of the first images you saw in that very popular building amongst his contemporaries. For him, it was the building that made his reputation in the way that Central Park had made Olmsted's, and it remains his best and most admired building. Again, I'm going to jump back into the book and read you a little portion of it. The year is 1872. On the morning of March 8, Richardson got a letter from the Trinity Church Building Committee. The name Henry Hobson Richardson was becoming known by then. He had already designed three New England churches, and the letter began with a familiar refrain: "You are requested to furnish designs for the erection of a church." This commission, he saw, would be different. The last three houses of worship had been, in effect, parish churches, and this one would be more like a cathedral, his and Boston's Duomo. As one of six invitees, Richardson's firm would be competing with the best architects in the country, including the redoubtable Richard Morris Hunt of New York and Boston's Peabody and Stearns. But Richardson possessed the least experience of the group, and the deadline, jotted at the foot of the letter he held in his hand, was short. Plans to be sent in on or before May 1, 1872. He had 6 weeks. Though Richardson could hardly predict the outcome, he did understand that the freshly opened letter he held in his hand represented a major opportunity. But he was unintimidated. Seated in his office near Manhattan's southern tip, the unruffled Richardson, on an otherwise unmemorable morning, simply went about doing what he loved best. He turned the letter over, picked up his pencil, and let it speak on the sheet's blank verso. In short order, he rendered in graphic form his first rapid-fire thoughts in an esquisse, a French term for very preliminary sketch, for what would be a very rudimentary floor plan. This is it. But it contained the germ of an idea that might suit very well. As you can see, this floor plan has the plus sign shape of a Greek cross with four short arms of equal length. Richardson noted the church's 90-foot breadth, the width specified in the letter, which was consistent with Trinity's recently acquired plot at the corner of St. James and Clarendon Streets in Boston's Back Bay. The architect's simple yet full-blown conception had come to him in an instant. As one young friend explained, Richardson had a rare intuitive sense that enabled him to strike at the foundation and grasp the whole of a truth at once. He soon made a trip to Boston to meet with the building committee and Trinity's rector, Phillips Brooks. Brooks told Richardson he didn't want a long nave and that he didn't much like steeples. The architect returned to New York, completed the competition drawings, and submitted them on time. Then he waited. The decision came promptly. In early June 1872, Richardson burst into the morning parlor of a neighbor's home. Brandishing a roll of drawings, he announced exuberantly, "I've got it." "I see you have," the lady of the house observed, bemused at the man's boisterous interruption of her family's quiet breakfast. "But what is it you have?" "I've got the church," Richardson exclaimed. "Trinity Church in Boston. I've got it." His thumbnail sketch, a crude crisscross of pencil strokes, had been an almost immediate epiphany that, as realized over the construction in the course of the next 5 years, became the great stone edifice today in Copley Square. In the same way that Central Park established Olmsted, making him the central figure in American landscape design, Trinity Church elevated Richardson to the position of the most admired architect of his era. Now, I make a case in the book that Olmsted and Richardson had an enduring impact on the American landscape. That's true in multiple places, but being in Chicago today, I want to talk about Richardson's last great work, a building that survives in the pages of textbooks, but sadly not on the streetscape. Once it filled the city block, bounded by Adams, Franklin, Quincy, and Wells streets. Pathetically, it's a four-story parking garage today. But for a century, it was the Marshall Field wholesale store. We'll get there in a minute, but first, there had been precedents. One dress rehearsal was a commercial structure that Richardson designed for his wife's siblings in Boston in 1875. The Hayden Building was tiny in comparison to what Fields would be, yet it has giant arches. It's a five-story building, but ambiguously so. Here's another antecedent. It's the 1876 Cheney Building in Hartford, Connecticut. You can see where Richardson's going. The footprint is larger. The elegant exteriors still look simpler than they actually were. At each of the buildings, a sequence of arch buildings grow smaller from the lower to the upper stories, which disguises floor levels and the building's overall height. Now let's go to Chicago. And here's the Field wholesale store. It's the Hayden Building on steroids. The footprint is much larger at 325 feet long and 190 feet deep, amounting to nearly an acre and a half of floor space per floor. The seven tall stories would top out at a cornice of 130 feet above the street. And since the store commanded an entire block, it would have four distinct public faces. This was a monster of a building, but one that did not look monstrous. One of Chicago's great men of architecture, Louis Sullivan, was stunned by it. When he first saw the building, then under construction, he promptly went back to the drawing board and revised his plans for what would become the auditorium building, replacing his own picturesque elements with Richardsonian broad arches. Nor was this Sullivan's first encounter with Richardson. As a kid, as a Boston kid, he had been mesmerized by Richardson's Brattle Square Church. As a first-year student at MIT, he was 17, and he was immediately converted. As he later wrote, the church became the fount of his architectural theology. He was a good writer, too, Sullivan. The building had been conceived and brought to light, Sullivan observed, by the mighty Richardson. Nor was Sullivan the only Chicagoan to fall under Richardson's spell. Let us note here that the word organic was used to describe Richardson's architecture long before the sage of Taliesin put it to use. That was, of course, in no small measure due to Richardson's collaborations with Olmsted and the way they integrated buildings into a landscape together. It's also notable that when Frank Lloyd Wright designed a home for his young family in Oak Park in 1889, he had just read a biography of none other than Henry Hobson Richardson, which, interestingly, was the first biography of an American architect ever published. It appeared the previous year, and interestingly, it was underwritten in part by Frederick Law Olmsted. It's no accident that he chose to build his home in the shingle style. Wright's debt to Richardson would be apparent in his later work also, and he frequently used low arches, stone piers, roof lines, and shingle elements that were unmistakably Richardsonian. If you look at Richardson's train stations, you can see the origins of the prairie style. I'm going to talk about a train station in a minute. Like so many other architects of his generation, Wright maintained that what he himself admitted was a secret respect leaning a little toward envy for H.H. Richardson. For Wright, that was quite an admission. Olmsted and Richardson could hardly have been more different. Somber and serious, man of the mind, Olmsted usually seemed preoccupied with big thoughts. In contrast, Richardson loved nothing more than a groaning board, fine food, lots of drink, and especially the company of a willing audience for his fount of stories and goodwill. He was a man of laughter, unafraid of tears. Olmsted was small, 5'6", and always thin, thanks to a nervous temperament. Excuse me. A solid 6-footer, Richardson was matinee idol handsome in his 20s, although he ballooned to 350 pounds thanks to kidney disease, which killed him at just 47. After Richardson moved to Massachusetts in 1874 to supervise the construction of Trinity, Olmsted began spending summers there. Late in the decade, he got his first major landscape commission in Boston, the Back Bay Fens, the first of many that resulted in what's known today as the Emerald Necklace, a series of parks. In 1881, he was thinking about moving his office to Massachusetts. As Olmsted's son Rick told the story, on a winter Sunday morning, first light revealed a thick blanket of fresh snow. Olmsted was staying with the Richardsons at their Brookline home at 25 Cottage Street, as he often did. He looked out of the window at the crystalline brightness and spied a horse-drawn snowplow and several laborers clearing the street, a process supervised by a town official on horseback. The tableau before him set his resolve. "This is a civilized community," he said, turning to his host and friend Richardson. "I'm going to live here." The home and property that Olmsted bought and subsequently developed, he named it Fairstead, is today a National Park Service site. It's a short walk to Richardson's Cottage Street home. The Olmsteds' move to Boston also cemented the friendship of the two men and that of their wives and children. Again, according to Rick Olmsted, Olmsted's youngest child, who was then a teenager, "I was in and out of their house and office all the time with father and the Richardson's children." Now, there's much more to say, but I don't think we have a lot of time left here. So I'm going to pick this up a little bit, and I'm going to touch on several projects. First of all, the public library. We take the institution of the public library for granted, but it wasn't until the third quarter of the 19th century that there was such a thing. There were libraries, of course, mercantile collections, university collections, that kind of thing, but there was no public library, just as there had been no parks until Olmsted came along. But Richardson, together with Olmsted, in some cases, created some early examples, models that were widely copied. This one, it's in Massachusetts, is in a perspective drawing from Richardson's office, was settled into the downtown streetscape. And for my money, it's more like, more than a bit park-like, a restful oasis for the mind and body. I'm going to show you another one here. There we go. This is the Wynn Library. There were more. There was another one in Quincy. There was another one at the University of Vermont. And they were as handsome on the inside as on the outside. There we go. Now, I can't talk about their times without reference to the railroad, which was the literal engine of economic growth and the matrix that bound the immensity of this country together in the 19th century. There's a telling example of this in Richardson's and Olmsted's work, namely their suburban rail stations. The context is that the U.S. population grew eightfold during Olmsted's life. He was born into a country where literally no one lived more than a mile or two from nature. We don't seem to be moving ahead here. There we go. Cities had only begun to spread in the 1820s when Olmsted was born, but all of a sudden the city exploded. Suburbs didn't exist, and then they did. Together, Olmsted and Richardson devised welcoming portals to suburbs like this one. Richardson's building sits long and low, unobtrusive and welcoming. Sorry. Once more, Olmsted made the station look like it belonged there. As their friend Charles Brig Sargent explained, the whole effect was to make the station seem part and parcel of nature's handiwork. Richardson himself designed fewer than a dozen railroad stations. His successor firm, Shepley, Rutan, and Coolidge, which took over after his death, designed a few dozen more. But hundreds and hundreds of imitations popped up across the country. Now, I can't not talk about another Richardson project that would influence the thinking of architects for generations. It's probably one worthy of a lecture all by itself. It's the so-called Ames Gate Lodge. The building, neither Georgian nor Greek, neither Gothic nor Richardsonian Romanesque, whoops, we lost it, there we go, did not fit into a neat category. It's not truly vernacular, since no one could point, sorry about this, to another building near or far that resembled it, although many would in the future, among them some of Frank Lloyd Wright's ground-hugging houses. This might be best described as geological, but whatever label you want to apply, the Gate Lodge was liberating. For Richardson, certainly, trained as he had been in the rituals of the École des Beaux-Arts, for Frederick Ames, the man who commissioned it, and for Olmsted, who, as a friend and advisor of Richardson, helped him plan it. As he increasingly liked to do, Richardson drew upon natural colors and textures, and under Olmsted's influence, the line of demarcation between the building and its site blurred. The building appears to have emerged from the ground on which it stood and stands, by the way, in northeastern Massachusetts. Back to Chicago for a couple of breaths. There's the Glessner House, a great favorite of mine, less than 2 miles from here. Speaking of which, I spend a chunk of my morning this morning at the Art Institute, where there's a William Morris show with the Glessner Gallery, a must for students of the arts and crafts, decorative arts. One of Olmsted's last great works was Biltmore on a mountaintop in North Carolina, owned by George Washington Vanderbilt. He saw another kind of opportunity, one that brought him full circle. A tree man before he became a park man, he pioneered sustainable forestry. Olmsted's work in Chicago is worthy of a lecture by itself, of course. There's Riverside, the nation's first planned community. It's a place, there we go, it's a place of such evident livability that its principles, the houses, were set well back from the streets, walks and wheelways were separated, the generous common grounds, all became received knowledge for untold thousands of suburban developments in the decades to come. There's, of course, Jackson Park, which, in Olmsted's good hands, would become the site of the World's Columbia Exposition. The White City, as it were. But others, not least Eric Larson in his The Devil in the White City, have told that story much better than I can in a sentence or two. On the other side of the country, there's also the Olmsted and Yosemite story to be told. He played a critical role in helping preserve the Sequoia at Mariposa and the Yosemite Valley. The briefing document he prepared in 1865 would, in effect, lay the philosophical groundwork for the creation of the National Park Service a generation later. As Olmsted was showing us how to integrate nature into our lives, Richardson was inventing American idioms, the shingle style, Richardson Romanesque, and the open plan. Now, as I was saying earlier, Richardson's name has long since lost the currency it had in the late 19th century. He died so young, he left a mere 80-odd buildings. In contrast, Wright left more than 500 and lived to age 91. Olmsted was a lifelong student of farming, of slavery, publishing of parks and parklands, and of botany and forestry and the building arts, and what we would call environmentalism, although that was a term he would not have recognized in his time. I would argue that all these pieces coalesced in his mind and his views about the scenic, as he liked to put it, and its roles in society, social class, and broadly speaking, the city. He was a true visionary. That's actually the biggest single epiphany that came to me in working on this book, that Olmsted could read the future. Now, some of that comes from the not-so-complicated understanding that landscapes take decades to mature. If you plant a tree too close to a house, which I've done, a few years later, you realize it's a problem. He understood that a landscape designer had to think not just a decade or two ahead, but generations into the future. As Charles Eliot Norton, president of Harvard, put it in a condolence note to Rick, few men have done better service beneficent not only to his own generation, but to generation after generation in the long future. Amen. Olmsted was a park maker with a deep sense of democracy. Richardson was a form giver. His rail stations, libraries, commercial buildings, and open plan houses redefined how Americans thought about buildings. Yet, I have to say that the most satisfying part of researching and writing this book was coming to understand the deep bond, akin to a brotherhood, that Richardson and Olmsted had. When I was writing this book, the working title I used was The Boulder Brothers. Together, they evolved a fresh vision, one that more often than not employed rude stonework to meld their constructions to existing terrain. Together, they addressed the demands of increasingly urban place. They catered to both democratic values and the American compulsion for pragmatic answers. And as the nation came into its own, these two men of genius employed the gifts of nature in their innate passion for beauty to redefine the country's rapidly changing landscape. I think we have some time for some questions and maybe some answers. Thank you. Jojo?
Excuse me, sir. Go ahead and speak correctly.
What would you say was the guiding spirit behind the Romanesque revival, and how does it inform us today?
Well, I guess you'd have to say that Richardson was a student of the past. So I guess, you know, his sense was that, you know, we don't have to invent everything anew every day. So I think that's certainly a piece of it. How does it inform us today? That's a good question. You know, I think that having been through a period of modernism, having been through a period where we tossed everything out, and through a period of postmodernism where we've begun to integrate miscellaneous classical things into our world, I think that maybe there's space for the Gothic and the space for the Richardsonian Romanesque, and there are some folks who are beginning to pay attention to this. I'd like to think there are going to be more of them, but I guess we'll need to stay tuned.
Any other questions?
I'm guessing that there's been a lot more written about Olmsted than Richardson, and I'm just curious what your guiding rule was in terms of what you would say in addition about Olmsted, perhaps that in a different way or something that hasn't already been written.
Yeah. Well, I think the by way of comment, yes, there have been lots of books. Interestingly, there was a biography of Richardson published that I mentioned that Olmsted helped underwrite in 1888. The first biography of Olmsted did not appear until the 1970s, which seems sort of extraordinary because Olmsted was this, you know, wildly influential figure. And he, when I travel, when I talk to people, when I do research, this happens to me all the time. People, you know, in unlikely cities will say to me, oh, we have an Olmsted Park. And about half the time, they do have a park that was designed by Frederick Law Olmsted, because they're in Louisville, they're in Atlanta, they're in, you know, on the West Coast, and they're, you know, all over the place. But about half the time, they're actually not right, because his son's practice was much larger than his, and in fact, a practice with the name Olmsted in it existed into the 1980s. So, that's just by way of aside. What I tried to do, despite the fact that there were lots of Olmsted biographies, and there have been other books about Richardson too, was investigate their relationship, which really hadn't been. You know, it got mentioned here and there. There was no question that they were friends. That came up here and there. But what I did was I went through the literature and I went through the paperwork that exists. There is a lot of Olmsted paperwork. Not so much Richardson, although there are many, many drawings. And I tried to find where their paths crossed and what their relationship was like and how one man influenced the other. So that's really the thrust of my book, which I think makes it a little bit different from some other very good biographies of Olmsted in particular. Microphone is coming your way.
Well, thank you for the great lecture. I just wanted to ask about urban architecture and the urban landscape. I was really taken by the asylum and how that was well integrated into nature, and how urban architects can better do that with the green space available here in the city while balancing an influx of population.
Yeah. The asylum, the insane asylum in Buffalo, by the way, much of the building still stands. And if you're interested in a hotel room while you're there, you can stay there. It's called the Henry. Aptly enough. Well, of course, they had the great advantage when they, and this is one of the challenges today of people who were interested in parks, is that when Olmsted and Richardson went to Buffalo, there was a whole bunch of empty space, you know, essentially unclaimed space. The same had been true in New York, that, you know, the place where Olmsted, where Central Park exists, there was essentially no development. There were a couple of communities, unfortunately, a pretty healthy African-American community that sort of had to get ejected from that space, but basically it was unused land. And there isn't so much of that these days. So there's a real challenge today in creating new park spaces. But I do think that there are good lessons about, in particular, at the insane asylum, in what Olmsted did, the most significant of which and the most useful of which, I think, is that he let what was there determine a great deal about what would be there after they did what they wanted to do, using the terrain, not trying to reinvent it, positioning the buildings in certain ways so that you took advantage not only of the solar effect, but you established a sense of privacy for, in this case, people who were trying to recover from mental challenges. I think there's a fair number of lessons in that. I would encourage you to, you know, learn a little more, read a little more about that project, because I think you picked one of the most interesting ones of their joint commissions. I see a hand here.
Oh. I think you've answered part of my question. I was going to ask, from whom did Olmsted acquire the land on which Central Park was built?
Actually, it was the state of New York that bought 825 odd acres using taxpayer monies. I think there were more than 5,000 separate parcels that had to be purchased in order to create that, you know, large contiguous rectangle of land. Took a number of years, and it was done by the time Olmsted came along. You know, it was the initial legislation was passed in 1853. By the time they were looking to find a superintendent and a designer for the park 4 years later, they had managed to accumulate that land. We have a follow-up here.
Wasn't this land owned by an African Methodist Episcopal Church group?
There was a section of Central Park that was called Seneca Village. There was a church, I believe. There were a couple of stores on the property, and there were a number of residences. And exactly how the purchase arrangement was done, I don't know, but it was a buy and sell. Was it a fair buy and sell? I couldn't go there because I don't know enough about it. But I think also that portion of land, which is, I believe, in what is today the Upper West Side in the low 80s, the high 70s of Manhattan, I think that constituted probably 2-3% of the actual park. Much of the rest of which was bought for a song because it had been used for a wide variety of things, including tanneries and, you know, and so on.
If you're alive today, how do you think Olmsted would weigh in on the Obama Presidential Center being built and his park?
You know, you're asking the wrong person, because really all I know is that it is an encroachment to some degree on a park. I mean, I've read that. I don't know any of the details. But I guess my instinct would be he would probably be opposed. One of the great unhappinesses in Olmsted's life was that he spent lots and lots of his later life trying to protect what he had done earlier in his life. So that, for example, in the case of Central Park, somebody wanted to put a racetrack in the park. And he fought like hell to prevent that from happening and succeeded in doing so. So although I must profess, again, ignorance as to the details of this, I think his instinct is a park, goddammit, and we don't really want to put this other stuff in there. Thank you very much. So maybe that's oversimplified, but.
That was the first half of my question, or just the thoughts about preservation in general. The Glessner House is near us. That neighborhood has changed a lot. Any thoughts yes. about your thoughts about preservation in general?
Well, you know, I started writing about Billings through a kind of preservation doorway, if you will, because I got very friendly with some people who were very much involved in the business. I'm very much in favor of preservation in general. I think that it's a real loss to erase artifacts from the past of any time. That said, I think that there is also sometimes a kind of unhappy relationship between gentrification and preservation, where what happens is the long-term denizens of a neighborhood get pushed out because the real estate prices get too high. And sometimes that is a consequence of people overvaluing the past and creating this network of rules and regulations whereby things have to stay as they were. So I think it's, you know, it's very much a moving target, and it depends on one neighborhood. One neighborhood is very different from the next one. So I think it's complicated. People have to think hard, and they have to talk, and they have to make best decisions possible, because you want it to be both at the same time a source of kind of historic understanding and appreciation of the good work of the past, and not advancing inequality, because that can definitely be an unfortunate side effect. I don't know if that answers your question, but you know, I do. There is that tension.
Was Olmsted still alive when the dispute rose up about putting the Metropolitan Museum of Art plunked down into Central Park? Or did he have a chance to try and rail against it, or what?
I think he was still alive. I think that was in the 80s. But I think by that point, he was no longer directly associated with the park. One of the reasons he moved to Boston was because he wanted to hang out with Henry Hobson Richardson. Another reason was because he had this great, wonderful series of commissions that helped create the Emerald Necklace, which, you know, is this, you know, kind of presence in Boston and a number of different communities. But another one was he was really sick and tired of the bureaucracy in New York because they were always jerking him around, not to put too fine a point on it. I guess I don't know the answer to that question. I don't remember in my research coming across the discussion of the Metropolitan Museum at all. It certainly existed then because Theodore Roosevelt Sr. was involved in it. But I don't know when they wanted to put it. Interestingly, the first incarnation of the Central Park version of the Metropolitan Museum was designed by Calvert Vaux, who was Olmsted's longtime partner. So it's also possible that Olmsted would have kept his counsel to himself. The short answer to this question is, I don't know. I'm going to do a little research and find out, though. I'm sorry, I can't give you a better answer.
Well, I only know about it from later writing when they wanted to expand the park.
Yes.
And then I read, you know, argument after argument
yes.
about wanting to preserve the park.
Right. Yes, yeah, and it's ongoing. I remember in my lifetime, there was a substantial addition put on the layman wing, which went into the park, and there was much consternation about that too, although it eventually did get constructed.
All righty, we have time for one more question. Just a brief reminder, copies of Mr. Howard's book are available for purchase in the DEF room. That is the room that is directly below us.
Which I'll be happy to sign, by the way, if anyone would like.
So obviously Olmsted and Richardson had a lovely friendship, and Richardson died young. So did Olmsted create another partnership like that, or did he just sort of work with lots of different architects?
He and Richardson never had a formal partnership. He did have a formal partnership with Calvin Vaux, which lasted from the 1850s off and on until the early 1870s. And most of the collaborations between Richardson and Olmsted postdated that. No, he never did form another partnership. However, actually, that's not quite true. He did form another partnership with his sons because it became Frederick Law Olmsted and Sons. And at some point when Olmsted finally in 1895 had to withdraw from the practice because he was losing his memory, he was losing Trey, just couldn't keep things as organized as he might. Then his sons took over and ran the practice very successfully until John died in 1825 and Rick lived on. I think he retired in 49, but the practice continued for, you know, a couple of decades after that. So it went on. And in the case of Olmsted, I kind of like the story that he was living in the McLean Institute in Boston, which is an existing hospital today for people with, you know, mental difficulties of various kinds. And he was there because he had some kind of senile dementia. But he wasn't so confused that he couldn't complain that he, having designed the original landscape for the McLean Hospital, they screwed it up. They didn't do it the way he wanted it. And he complained about it a lot, even after he, you know, didn't even know the names of his grandkids. But he knew they hadn't followed his plan. So anyway, thank you all for coming out. This was great.